Good morning, everyone. Today it gives us great joy to welcome back Swami Harinamananda, who is well known to many of us here in New York. Since 2008, he's been resident minister of the San Diego Monastery, a branch of the Vedanta Society of Southern California. And he also currently serves as president of the Interreligious Council of San Diego. Swami Harinamananda was born in the US and received his master's in socioeconomics from the University of California, Davis. He joined the order in 1996 in Hollywood and served as revered Swami Swahananda's attendant for 5 years before going to the training seminary at Belo Mat. Upon his return to America, he served in the Tribuco Monastery, Hollywood, before taking his final vows as a monk in 2008. He will speak to us today on decoding the Chandi.
Let's begin with the chant. If you know the chant, just chant along. Asatoma.
Om Asatoma Satgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya Avir Avir Maiti Rudrayate Dakshinam Mukham Tenamam Pahinityam Tenamam Pahinityam Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from darkness to light. Lead us from death to immortality. O Lord, guide us through and through, and ever protect us with thy loving presence. Om, peace, peace, peace. Well, it's good to be back in New York. It's good to see you again, familiar faces. today, we are going to be speaking about the Chandi. Actually, the topic is decoding the Chandi. And before I begin, how many people are familiar with the Chandi by show of hands? Okay. How many people chant the Chandi on a somewhat regular basis? Okay, good. So we've got quite a few people of this that are familiar with it. this talk, I'm going to try to give you, I think, maybe a new perspective on what the Chandi is. And as I talk about this, I hope that you're going to start to discover that the Chandi is actually a spiritual map that will take us in the course of our spiritual evolution. So, do you know Swami, revered Swami, Tathagatananji Maharaj, used to chant the Chandi? You're aware of that, right? Most of you, right? I heard he used to chant it every day. I also heard that he used to shout out that Chandi in the streets of New York City. Was that true as well? Anybody hear that? Okay, some people heard that. So, why was he doing that? What message was he trying to convey to the city of New York? Today, we're going to try to discover that message. What you'll find is most people who read the Chandi will read different parts of it. It's a way to connect with the Divine Mother. And I've seen Swamis who talk to, especially women, sometimes who are battered women that have been abused, what will they tell them to get strength? Read the Chandi. It gives you strength, it gives you power. I mean, you see Swami Tathagatananji Maharaj? What is he? He's the embodiment of Shakti. If you're anywhere in his presence, you know, you get zapped. He has that Shakti power. Where is that coming from? That chanting was for a purpose. So today we're going to discover what was the message of that Chandi, because a lot of us read it, but what happens is we get lost in the detail. The Chandi has a lot of blood, a lot of battles, and it's sometimes kind of like very graphic, and you can get lost in all of that. But through that whole scripture, you're going to start to discover there's actually a, a spiritual unfoldment occurring. Okay. And one thing I do want to say about this, sometimes people ask me, is the Chandi, is it something historical? Is it a myth? You know, the definition of myth actually is not a fabricated story. Myth actually comes from the word mythos, which means story, sacred stories. And the Chandi could have happened here in a time on this phase, plane of existence. It could have happened in another loka of existence. It could, even today we're going to be looking at it as a vision. It's a mystic truth. It's a spiritual principle that was experienced by some sages. And they're trying to express that message to us. Today we're going to try to decode what that message is. Okay. So before I begin now, let me tell you, this talk actually, because it has three sections, it's actually a 3-hour talk, all right? So I'm going to try to condense that in a very short way. And maybe during the Q&A, if some things get lost, you can ask me. So the Chandi, how many verses does the Chandi have? It has 700 verses. What other scripture has 700 verses? Bhagavad Gita. The Chandi is the Bhagavad Gita in the Shakta tradition. It's also known as the Devi Mahatmya and the Durga Saptashati, the glories of the Divine Mother. And if you want to get to know the Divine Mother, this is the textbook to read. There's one Divine Mother, but according to her function, she takes on different forms and expresses different powers. And when you summarize all these powers and functions, it boils down, I think, into two basic identities. The mother has the power, what we call, there's a motherly quality, Ambika, and there's another quality that comes out, Chandi, Chandika. What does Chandi mean? Come on, everybody's been studying the Chandi, reading the Chandi. What does the Chandi mean? Huh?
Warrior?
No, okay. Literally, it means, Chandi means terrible, ferocious. Okay. So the mother has two aspects, a sweet, loving, motherly side and a ferocious side. When does she express her ferocious side? Well, you'll see like when a lion to its cub, when we come to spiritual life, when we open our heart, opens up to spiritual life, we start to get embraced by this universal mother. And what happens? That mother starts to nourish us, starts to love us, and she starts to embrace us. And what happens then is that she is the loving mother. But anything towards cubs, she becomes very fierce, very ferocious, because she wants to protect the cubs. Anything that tries to take you away for your spiritual life, towards your spiritual life, once you come into the presence of mother, she becomes ferocious too. We had a disciple of Swami Swahananda, a Swami in Southern California, his doctor said, Maharaj, you know, now when I've come to spiritual life, I find that my life is starting to get feeling worse and worse and worse. I feel more suffering. And when I look at my doctor friends, I see that they're enjoying life. They're having fun. They're going to parties. Well, I thought spiritual life was supposed to be easier when I come. Why did I come? You know what Swami Swamiji Maharaj said? Maharaj had said that when you come to the presence of the Divine Mother, when you come to the gravitational pull of the Divine, what begins to happen? When you come to the atmosphere, when a meteorite comes to the atmosphere of Earth, what happens? The friction, it begins to burn up. Tapas, heat. When you become to the presence of the Divine Mother, Chandi also means that which rips away. What does she rip away? She starts to rip away yet your body identification, your mental identification, your ego identification. She starts to strip away things that will take you away from her, your spiritual life. And it can be extremely painful. She wants to purify, cleanse you. That's when you get in the presence of her. This is Chandi. She wants you all to herself. Okay. So And the Chandi, the way we're going to be looking at it, is it's an allegory, a battle that occurs within us between the divine and the demonic, between the positive and negative forces within us, between the forces of light and the forces of darkness. So when they talk about the battle of the gods and the asuras, the demons, this is the battlefield. They're within us. And it's the good and evil within us. And Swami Sarvapinanda actually mentioned this. If you want to look at a scripture to see what the message is, find out what's being repeated. So when we look at the Chandi, we'll find maybe there's three things that get repeated. One is that the Divine Mother is one, and she creates, she projects the many. We all have one common source, one mother. So from the one, you're going to have positive charges and negative charges. Positive energy, negative energies. You're going to have protons, electrons, matter, antimatter. So you're going to have suric qualities, godly qualities being manifested. You're also going to have asuric qualities, negative qualities also being manifested. But both come from the same source. So both the gods and the demons have one common mother. Okay, they all come from that divine mother herself. The second thing you're going to start to see is that whenever there's an imbalance within the cosmos, whenever there's more negative energies rising within us, the divine mother begins to manifest. And what I'm going to be talking about the Chandi today is how we embody it. So when our negative internal energies start to rise above our positive energies, she starts to take birth in us to restore balance and harmony so that we can grow and evolve. And the last thing, another thing that you'll start to see, is that the Divine Mother never says that any of us are going to avoid suffering. But she gives us an assurance. We have to suffer because that's the karma that we've accrued, and we have to go through our karmic baggage. She does say, though, that during times of crisis, if you call on her, she will help you. She'll give you the strength. She'll give you the strength to help you go through that experience, so that it becomes. It helps you go. It helps you evolve and grow. This is an assurance to us. So ultimately, what you start to begin to discover is that the Divine Mother, you start to see, is our own true being, our inherent divinity, our inherent wholeness. And her clashes with the demons symbolize our outward, inward struggles that we face with our ego. Okay. All right. How many main stories does the Chandi have? Anybody? 10? Okay, how many main stories are depicted in the Chandi? Right, there are three main stories, okay? And these three stories represent the threefold transformation of consciousness from our tamasic inert nature, story number one, to our rajasic active nature, story number two, to our sattvic nature in story number three. It's actually a blueprint of the spiritual map. It's the journey from limited consciousness to expanded consciousness. And the transformation of this involves the gunas. So just quickly, what are the gunas? The gunas are qualities, energies, forces in nature and behind our mind. The predominance of one guna over the other causes us to feel sometimes the feeling of stagnation, or the feeling of restlessness, or to get insights. When you're in a tamasic state of mind, tamas is defined as inertia. It covers the ego, okay? With all the impurities, mala, it covers the ego, and it makes you feel darkness. You feel inactive, and you feel confused. When you're feeling the ego is in this rajasic state, rajas is defined as activity. What is it? It projects out the ego. When that happens, you start to feel restless. You have desires, and you feel dissatisfied. In the sattva, when our ego is in that sattvic level, sattva is defined as the revealing power of the ego. And when you get in that state of mind, you feel a sense of balance. You feel a sense of joy. You gain insight. So what we see is that these are three states of mind. And they define how we experience things. Okay? These are three ways of experiencing the same situation. If we were at a monk's conference, for example, and maybe Swami Sarvapriyananda was speaking, right? And say it's at a big monk's, and maybe as he's speaking, some monk may feel, oh gosh, he's such a good speaker. I can never be like that. I shouldn't even try. They might start to feel depressed. Other monks may feel that, oh my God, he has so many YouTube hits. You know, I can also be like that. I should also speak like that. It starts to bring out your competitive nature. And other of us will be sitting there saying, wow, I get so immersed while he's talking. I lose sight of time. I get so many insights. That's sattvic nature. So all of us, we go through these three states of mind during the course of the day. So this is what the Chandi is about. It's the threefold transformation of consciousness described in these three sections. Okay, so what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to give you, if we only had like 2 minutes to explain what the Chandi was, I'm going to give you the cliff notes, all right? It's what we call the cheat sheet. So before we used to take exams, if you didn't study for the exam, look at the cliff notes and then try your best. So here are the cliff notes to the Chandi. If you know this, when you read the Chandi, you'll at least be able to pass the exam. So let's see what we have here. Okay, I'll read this to you because it's kind of small print. The first question that arises in the Chandi is what causes attachment? There are two characters, Surata and Samadhi. They have knowledge of what's causing them attachment, yet they experience pain. They can't let go. What causes attachment? What's the mechanism behind attachment? Why can't we let go of the things that are causing us pain and suffering? If I were to ask you, why did you come to spiritual life here? Why are you here right now? There is something that has brought you here. What's the question or what's the problem that needs to be solved in your life? So, these two people, Surat and Samadhi, talking about their sense of attachment and the pain they're feeling from attachment, go to a sage, Medha. And Medha says simply, the cause of attachment is Mahamaya. She's deluding us, but she can also remove it. Then the next question is, well, what are the ways she's deluding us? Medha says, three ways. In the first story, the first way she's deluding you is through ignorance and fear. And when that happens, you develop the Madhu Kaitava personality. The second way she's deluding you is through the need for power and control. When we feel the need for greed, fame, domination, guess what happens? You develop the Mahishasura personality. The third way she's deluding you is through the need for pride and recognition. And when that happens, you develop the Shumba Nishumba personality. Now, the next question that follows up then, well, if she's deluding us in these ways, what can we do to remove that delusion? Simply, in the Chandi, it states, through worship and prayer. When you're feeling tamas, what do? Chant the Brahma Stuti to awaken Vishnu, your own consciousness. When you are feeling rajasic and feeling the obstacles of rajas, you invoke divine rajas so that all your fragmented consciousness starts to be coalesced, unified, singular, and the divine starts to manifest. When you feel the effects of even sattva, yes, sattva, there are obstacles. Chanti aparajita stuti, the Ya Devi Sarva Bhuteshu, to see the divine in all her manifestations, in all her forms, to remove even the last impediment of sattva, so that you can merge into the divine. The next question is then, how does she manifest? Well, in the first story, she manifests as Kali, to cut the delusion and to awaken your ego. In the second story, she manifests as Lakshmi, the rajasic aspect of the divine, to give you abundance, to give you what you need, so that you can ripen and mature that ego. And in the third story, she manifests as Saraswati, to give you knowledge. For what purpose? So you can finally cut that ego. It doesn't serve a purpose now in your interaction with the divine. Okay. Is that understood? Okay, so this is the cheat sheet here. So now I think we can actually stop this lecture and you can read this book and we're ready to go, all right? All right, now what I'd like to do with this remaining time is I'm going to try my best to go through all three stories, all right? And then we're going to analyze and decode what they mean. Okay, so let's begin. Is that the Chandi begins with the king named Suratha. He's a righteous king that was defeated by a smaller sized enemy. Now the defeated king was further robbed of his treasury and army by his own ministers. Embarrassed, he arrives in a hermitage of a sage in a dense forest. His mind is overcome by deep attachment to everything he's lost. He lost his kingdom, his subject, even his elephants he was worried about. What's going to happen to them? The king saw a merchant and asked the merchant, "Who are you and why are you so sad?" The merchant said, "I am a merchant named Samadhi, of good character, born in a wealthy family. Now, because of my family's greed, my wife and son have taken away my wealth and have cast me out. Dwelling here in this forest, I still wonder about their welfare. How are they living? Are my sons living good lives?" Thereupon, the king asked the merchant, "Why is your mind so affectionately attached to those covetous relatives who have deprived you of your wealth? Why are you still thinking about them?" The merchant replied, "You know, this very thought also has occurred to me. But what can I do? I still hold a deep affection for those who have caused me pain, humiliation, and have stripped me away of everything. How is it I still love them? On account of them, I have heavy sighs." The merchant and the king then go and they approach a sage. The sage's name is Medha. And they ask him, the sage, "Why are we so miserable? How is it we who should know better are still deeply pained, even though we've been betrayed and unfairly treated? Knowing the pain and suffering our loved ones have caused, why can't we let them go?" Now, let's just look into this. First person to come is the king Suratha. When the way to investigate the scriptures is the name tells you the essence of it's a good feature of what's going on here. Suratha, what does Suratha mean? Su means good, Ratha means vehicle, a chariot. One who has a good body, okay? Suratha can also mean Suratha. Sura, we just said, is godly qualities. You have godly and you have asuras, not godly. So Tha means mountain, one who has a mountain of godly qualities. So he's a king that has a strong body and he's got strong virtues. He meets the sage, he meets the merchant, Samadhi. So Samadhi, you know, he means spiritual union. Ultimately, he gets a spiritual union with God. It can also mean one-pointed focus. And when our attention is primarily focused on our body and mind. We need a strong body and we need a strong mind. Now they come and they meet a sage. The sage's name is Medha, right? What does Medha mean?
Intelligence.
Intelligence. when our spiritual intelligence awakens, when our buddhi awakens, the way we chant Gayatri Mantra, to awaken the D, what happens? It shifts our awareness from our body and mind to our spiritual center. And this is what Surata and Samadhi happens when they meet Medha. Medha is going to take them to the Divine Mother. Okay. So, the question though they asked is, why is it we're attached to the very things that cause us suffering? I'm sure all of us have this experience. There are times when we think that, I know this is not right for me, but I can't let go. It could be a relationship. It could be something of an addiction. No matter what I try, I still can't let go. So, why can't I detach from the object of my affection, knowing that they're the source of my pain? Well, Medha could have said, why? And they would say, Medha could, and then Samadhi would have said, well, it's because I value that person. Why do you value that person? Because they feel a need. Well, what need do they fill? My wife feels the need for love. So here, then, what Medha could have done, he could have said, all right, I'm going to send you on the bachelor show, and we're going to find you another wife, and that will solve that problem. He doesn't do that. What does he do? He wants to take them to the source of all love. He doesn't want to give them a temporary solution. He wants to give them a permanent solution. The reason we come to spiritual life here is not necessarily to find temporary solutions, is to find a permanent solution. So, the sage Medha then says, when asked about the delusion, what's causing us pain, the cause of your delusion is the goddess Mahamaya. Nitaivasa jaganmurti taya sarvam idam tatam tattapi tat samutpattir bahudashru yatam mama. She is eternal, having the world as her form. She pervades all this, yet she creates attachment to continue this cycle. She's closer than anything you know. Usually sometimes she's so close, what happens to things that are so close? We can't see them. We see through them. People that are so close to us, sometimes they say, you don't see me. We see through them. We see all her forms and her various manifestations, but yet we don't see her. She's Srishti, Sthiti, Pralaya, Nigraha, Anugraha. She creates this world. She sustains this world. She creates bondage by putting you into a material existence. And then she creates a lacking within you so that you have a sense of attachment. But she's also the one that can give us liberation through knowledge or love. So now the sage is going to describe three stories in the way of the power of the Mahamaya, how she works, and how we can get out. So let's take a look at the first story now. So the sage describes now to Surata and Samadhi. During the period of cosmic dissolution, when the universe was one vast stretch of causal ocean, Lord Vishnu reclined on the serpent Adisesha and was in a state of deep mystic sleep. Now, two terrible demons, Madhu and Kaitava, sprung from the wax of Vishnu's ear, and they sought to slay Brahma, the Lord of creation. Now, Brahma, who's sitting in this lotus of Vishnu's navel, then prays to the great goddess, the Divine Mother, requesting her to withdraw from Vishnu so he can awaken and slay the demons. So the Devi is extolled by Brahma as the incomparable goddess. Thereupon, the Devi, who herself causes delusion, withdrew herself from every part of Vishnu. And released from Yogamaya, Vishnu got up. He saw Madhu and Kaitava, the two demons, trying to kill Brahma. And then what does he do? He goes and he battles them. And this battle lasts for 5,000 years. It's coming at a stalemate. No one's winning, no one's losing. So what happens? Mahamaya, the Devi, comes back and she deludes the two demons, Madhu and Kaitaba, thinking, giving them arrogance, thinking, gosh, we are so great, you know? And you know what? You, Vishnu, you fought so great. We're going to give a boon to you because you fought so great. What does Vishnu say? Let me kill you. Okay? So all of a sudden, Madhu and Kaitaba waken from this delusion. They think, what did we say? How do we get out of this? So they look all around and they see there's water everywhere. And they say to Vishnu, kill us in the place where there is no water. So what does Vishnu do? He takes his thigh out from the water, puts Madhu and Kaitaba, the two demons, on his thigh, takes his discus and chops their head off. This is the story. Simple story. Actually, these were some of the pictures here I forgot to go through. But now, let's start analyzing this. Because I think if you can get this, it's quite an amazing story. What is happening? This is the period of cosmic dissolution, right? Pralaya. Before activity, before the universe is projected out, there's the time of rest. So in this cosmic dissolution, at that time, now we see Brahma beginning to emerge. Whenever there's a positive charge, what happens? A negative charge also comes. Madhu and Kaitaba. Okay? So what happens is they are born out of ignorance. They come from the mala of Vishnu's ear. Who is Madhu and who is Kaitaba? Madhu, what does Madhu mean? Anybody? Sweet, honey. Okay? What does Kaitaba mean? Kaitaba comes from the root ketu, which means insect, okay? Here in this reference, we're going to see honey and honeybee, right? Now, try to get this with me. Madhu is the sweetness of remaining in ignorance. These are inertic forces to counterbalance Brahma. They want us to stay asleep, okay? They are the forces. When we face difficulties, troubles, we want to avoid them. We want to, what's the best thing to do when you're in difficulties? What's the best thing, huh? Escape. How do you escape? Sleep. Go into deep sleep. You have no problems there. Just go to sleep. Forget about the wrong. These are the things we're trying to avoid. So Madhu is the sweetness of staying in ignorance. Kaitaba is the sting. A bee, what does a bee do? It stings. When we try to move out of ignorance, the judgmental voice, the critical voice within us starts speaking. You're not good enough to do that. You're not worthy enough to do that. Who says you're going to get rejected? These are the two tamasic forces that are pulling us back so to not face the obstacles that we have to go through. Sometimes how to escape when the feeling of Madhu, what's the feeling of sweetness to remain in ignorance? Go get junk food, okay? Go watch TV. Go to the internet. What are our forms of distractions that help us avoid the things that we have to face? Addictions are all about Madhu and Kaitaba. Are you getting this? So Madhu and Kaitaba are the inertic forces that Madhu is the craving for sweetness to remain in ignorance. Kaitaba is the aversion, the pain that we're going to experience if we move out. Right now, Madhu and Kaitaba are coming because they want to remain in cosmic ignorance. They don't want the universe to project out. When you manifest Madhu and Kaitaba within yourself, how do you feel? When you feel that resistance, you're supposed to face somebody, but you don't want to face them. What do you do? Suppose we're supposed to ask our boss for a raise, but we're afraid to ask for a raise because they may reject us. They may say we're not worthy about it. So instead we say, next day, next day. So what do you feel when Madhu and Kaitaba, I'm going to bring the Upanishad, I'm going to bring this Purana is about us. It's not about something outside. It's about how we embody it. So when we feel Madhu and Kaitaba, what does honey feel like? Sweet. No, if you ever touch honey, what does it feel like? Sticky. You're stuck. You don't feel you can move, okay? You also feel indecisive. You don't know whether to go this way or this way. When you're stuck in that honey, you also feel heavy. You feel tamasic. You don't know what to do. You feel lazy. You begin to procrastinate. You feel lonely and helpless. This is the state that Madhun Kaitava put us in. What covers us? Fears, regrets, pain. The physical sensations we feel when we feel like this, our consciousness is constricted in that tamasic state. Sometimes we feel constipated, okay? We feel actually groggy. When you start taking tamasic food, when you don't want to deal with the situation, the best way is to make your mind foggy, bewildered. You start to feel numb. If you say this to your partner, and you know your partner is going to confront you, and a lot of pain is going to arise. With our parents, we may want to say that we don't want to go in their way, we want to go in a different way, but we're afraid because of the fear of the rejection of the pain that we're going to experience. So, Madhun Kaitava, so you start to feel, you start to numb, withdrawn, and depressed. The identity you start to feel like is you start to feel like a victim, a loser. And what do you start to do? You start to develop escape mechanisms called avoida Vedanta. Okay? You avoid, learn things how to avoid, okay? So like I said, there's junk food eating, TV binging, internet using, there's hardcore drinking. You escape into fantasy land and you have excuses. Oh, if only this were to happen, then I would do this. If I do this, what if this happens? And always the favorite word, but. This is Madhu Kaitava. When but occurs, that's Madhu and Kaitava manifesting within you. You know, sometimes, like, for example, when I have to write a paper, I may look at it and stare at a blank document and think, I'm not smart enough to write this. And even if I write it, what will people think? And after I lecture, it's writing so hard. What if I do a bad job? For disappointment, these beliefs limit us. They constrict us. So Madhu is the force that wants to suppress the growth impulse, and Kaitava is the force that wants to kill that growth impulse. We have to think for ourselves, what triggers us to put us in that tamasic state? Each one of us will have different triggers. And just to self-examine, what is it? And when you are in that tamasic state, how do you react? So when does tamas end? It begins with depression and ends in agitation. You say to yourself, you know what? I'm tired of being sick and tired. I feel like I have to do something now. Enough. I have to face the brute. So what happens? Well, from the Manipura chakra, the navel of Vishnu, out arises a lotus. The lotus is the awakening of consciousness. And there, inside that lotus, Brahma emerges. Who is Brahma? The creator. He's within us. He's our creative force. The force that wants to awaken. The deep desire to change within, to do something. Brahma wants to express out this universe. We want to express our own creativity, our spontaneity, to be who we are. But we feel helpless. Brahma feels helpless because he's got Madhun Kaitava coming up, going to kill him. And he's trying to awaken Vishnu, but Vishnu's not waking up. So when there's no other help to be seen, what do? You start praying. Who do you pray to? You pray to the Divine Mother. What does he pray? He prays the Brahmastiti. So let's pray a little bit. Let's just do a little of this prayer. For those that know it, chant along with me. This will, when you're in tamas, this will awaken you from tamas. Okay? Oops. That song I didn't play. Pink Floyd was a great feeling for what it's like to be in tamas. Okay. Now we're in Brahma. Put ourselves in Brahma's position. We're helpless. Let's chant to the Divine Mother a little bit.
Tvam swaha, tvam swada, tvam hi vashatkara suratmika, shuddha tvam akshare nitye, tridat matratnika stita, ardha matra stita nitya, yanuscharya visheshataha, tvam eva sa tvam savritti, tvam deva janani para, tvayaitat daryate vishvam, tvayaitrat sijyate jagat, Tvayaitat palyate devi, tumatsante cha sarvada, vishishtau shishti rupa tvam, stiti rupa cha palane, tata samhriti rupante, jagatosya jagan mahe, mahavidya mahamaya, mahameda mahasmritihi, mahamoha cha bhavati, mahadevi mahasuri.
What is Brahma chanting? The Divine Mother has says, I am everywhere. What is Brahma on that lotus in Pralaya experiencing right now? Mother, you're everywhere. So let me invoke you in what I'm experiencing. What am I experiencing? You are Swaha. You're the offerings that are coming to the gods. You are Swada. You're the offerings that are coming to the departed ancestors. You're the Swaratmika. At this point, only the primal vibrations are going on. You're the essence of all sound. You are Shuddha Tvam. You're the pure sound. You're Tridatmika. You're the essence of the vowels, Ah, Uma. At this point, the primal vibration, Om, is about to spring forth to manifest the universe. Tom Deva Jananipara, you are the Supreme Mother. At the end of this eulogy, at the end of this prayer, whenever we pray to the Divine Mother, we make a request at the end called a sankalpa. Not a demand, a request. What is Brahma's request? May you awaken Vishnu and have him slay Madhu and Kaitaba. What happens? She withdraws herself, Mahamaya, from Vishnu. For us, what does it mean? It means when we're in that tamasic state, we don't realize that what we're doing is affecting others. And when the tamas begins to be removed, we start to see that our actions have consequences. And our actions are hurting others or even hurting ourselves. And then what happens? Is we begin to take action. What happens? Vishnu awakens, and now he wants to fight. He's going to try to fight Madhu and Kaitaba. For us, it's struggle. We begin to struggle. We have these addictions. We have these things we're avoiding, our fears. But we're going to try to struggle through them. So we struggle, struggle, struggle. How long does Vishnu fight for? 5,000 years. What happens? Is he winning or losing? It's nothing's happening. It's a stalemate. You're going to struggle and struggle and struggle. Okay. But what happens? At some point, you will find that maybe you're not winning. Maybe you're still the pain you're experiencing of not being able to let go of the person who you should let go of. The problems, the addictions that you're supposed to do are not. You're having a struggle. You can't let them go. The Divine Mother subdues these. She comes back, she subdues Madhu and Kaitaba. She subdues our addictions. They start to feel lighter. They start to feel more free. And eventually we can say goodbye and let them go. You know, there's here in the United States, one of the things is Alcoholics Anonymous. They have 12 steps. And the first step, they say, is we admit we're powerless over the addictions and that our lives have become unmanageable. That's Brahma speaking. I admit I cannot do anything about the difficulties I'm in right now. Second step, we believe a power greater than ourselves can restore us to sanity. I believe there's a conscious being that can hear my prayers and who can respond to me. Seventh, humbly ask God to remove our shortcomings. I pray to the Mother, help me. 12th step, have a spiritual awakening. If the Divine Mother were to show her presence to you, if her vision was to come to you, how would you feel? How would you feel if you were to see this vision of her? Anybody? Blissful. You would start to feel love. You wouldn't feel lonely. You start to feel accepted. You start to become more open, connected. And you start to feel that in the presence of Mother, when you have that vision of the Divine Mother, people who came to Mother would feel that she was absorbing their guilt, their pain, their suffering. It's not that she solves your problem, she dissolves your problem. And the result is, you feel you're no longer responsible. She takes responsibility for you. This is the Divine Presence. So, for us, how do we recognize her grace when we're going through this struggling? For some of us, maybe a new perspective opens up, a new meaning, a new insight, a new purpose arises within us. And then we can move on. We can let the problems go and we can move on. So, what you begin to see is that the need to change, when you feel helpless and find no other solution, try to link to the Divine Mother through prayer, through worship, through mantra, through yoga. And what happens is when you connect, you get a downpour. The mantra connects you to that source, and then she downpours knowledge, strength, courage to make you move on. Okay. So that is the essence of the first story, Madhun Kaithaba. How do we deal with Madhun Kaithaba when they manifest within us? Okay. All right, story doesn't end here. Okay, we just touched the first story. Now, what happens is, after you've gone through Tamas, and I was going to show you that, another thing. This coin here is what's given to the in any type of addiction program. It's to say that I'm 1 month, you know, I have this coin. Reminds me every day I can always fall off track. Just because I've defeated Madhun Kaithaba doesn't mean that they're not going to come back. So every day I'm always careful and vigilant. And I have to, what is it? I have to be connected with the Mother. That cord that's coming out of Brahma is our umbilical cord. Somehow we've got separated, but we're always attached. So we have to go remember that we're attached and always call, always hold her hand in everything that we do. Okay, so now you've become strong. You've overcome Tamas, and you feel her grace. And now you start to become Rajasic. There are good qualities of Rajas. You start to become somebody. You start to do something. And you acquire qualities of virtues. You become organized. You're daring. You become confident, persuasive. Okay. In this, there are also things that happen when you start to be successful. Are there pitfalls to success? Okay. Maybe you start to want the name and fame. Maybe you become a little bit prideful. Maybe you start to need the recognition. You don't want to let go of what you have, of the possessions that you obtained. So your virtues start to become vices. Your organizational ability starts to become obsessive. Your daring quality turns into risk. Your confidence becomes arrogance. And your persuasiveness becomes domineering. And this is what leads us to the second story, the Rajasic ego. Okay, so the second story begins with, story goes. Okay. Can we lower the volume?
Yeah, good.
Lower, keep lowering. I wanted to give you a little Rajasic sense by playing a little Eminem in the background. The story goes, in ancient times, when Mahishasura, a buffalo beast, was the lord of the demons, and Indra was king of the heavens, there was a war between the gods and goddesses that lasted a full 100 years. The greatly virile demon defeated the army of the gods. After conquering the gods, Mahishasura took over the world and heavens. The defeated gods went to Brahma, Shiva, and Vishnu and complained about the atrocities of the demon. Hearing this, Vishnu, Shiva, and Brahma, and the other gods became angry. The rays of their powers combined and coalesced to become the goddess Durga. The gods worshiped Ma Durga, and she roared and laughed, filling the sky with her sound. And the gods exclaimed, "Victory unto you!" and praised her with devotion. The demon Mahishasura, in anger, he exclaimed, "Ah, what is this?" And he rushed towards that roar. He beheld the goddess pervading the three worlds. Her feet touched the ground. Her crown scraped the sky. Mahishasura's army and general and soldiers fought the Divine Mother fiercely, and they eventually got slayed. Seeing his army being destroyed, Mahishasura took the form of a buffalo, and he rushed to the mother lion. But Durga stood firm. She, the great goddess, and he, the maddened buffalo demon, came face to face. Mahishasura, with nostrils flaring, and the mother, calm of gaze. Mahishasura struck the earth with his hooves, and he bellowed frightfully, "Who was this woman to stand in my way?" He advanced, and Durga, arousing her own rage, resolved to slay him. She threw her noose over his buffalo body and bound him tightly. Now, shaking convulsively, he assumed the shape of a lion, and he slipped out of the noose. He lunged at the Devi, and she severed his head with her sharp-edged sword. But in an instant, the evil Mahishasura again reappeared as a man with sword and shield. And before he could move against her, she cut him to shreds with a volley of arrows. Taking the form of an elephant, he grasped the noble lion of Mother Durga with his trunk and dragged the lion along, trumpeting wildly. Now, in a flash, Durga's shining sword descended and severed the trunk. Now, once more, Mahishasura assumed his buffalo body and caused the three worlds to tremble. Durga, angered, drank a divine potion distilled from pure rajas, and her eyes were reddened. Her hair blew over her face, and her expression grew frightful, and bone-chilling laughter rolled off her lips. She leaped upon the buffalo demon and pinned his neck under her foot and pierced him with her spear. Trapped and crushed by her might, Mahishasura transitioned from a buffalo halfway into a human form, his true form. Thus exposed and fighting, he fell to the Devi Durga, beheaded by her great sword. Screaming and crying, the remaining demons ran away, and all the gods became joyous, and with satisfaction, they started singing praises to the great goddess. Okay, so this is the story that you'll read in the Chandi. This deals with the rajasic ego. When we are driven for lust, greed, power, and material pleasure. And it requires a fiery, dynamic form of the Divine Mother to combat our worldly rajasic sense. So let's look at this now. Who is Indra? Who is Indra? Indra is the king of the gods, yes. Indra is also within us. He represents our healthy ego. Okay, our normal healthy ego. He's in charge of the indriyas. Indriyas are our senses. So our senses are taking information from the world, and we're using this information to grow and evolve. This is Indra in its normal state. What happens is Mahishasura comes. And what does Mahishasura do? Who is Mahishasura? Okay, he is king of the demons, and he's taken over the three worlds, right? Within us, he is our selfish, narcissistic, instinctual ego, whose focus is on power, pleasure, and greed. Okay. And what happens? He takes over the three worlds. What are the three worlds within us? Our physical body, our mental body, our causal body. He has come. Not only is it pervading within my physical sense, where I need power, pleasure, and I need to be in control, He's pervading my dreams. I dream of power. I dream of pleasure. I dream of control. And he's leaving an impression in my causal body, seeds in there of power, pleasure, and control. I have become him in every bit of the term. Okay? And he is controlled by these six generals. How did Mahishasura become so powerful? How did he become so powerful? Well, he did austerities, and was granted a boon by Brahma. Okay? What did he want? What all demons want. We want to become, they want to become immortal. Okay? And what did Brahma say? Brahma says, that's not possible because anything that's born has to die. So then Mahishasura is trying to, how can I get away so that I can become immortal? Okay, let me think. Okay. Let me not be killed by any man or any god, thinking that will make him immortal. Okay? He forgot about the women's movement here. So, within us, if I were to ask you, again, how do we embody this scripture? When is Mahishasura take over us? Under what conditions does that anger, does that rage, that sense for control start to arise within us? When we are rejected, when we are criticized, you'll start to notice Mahishasura starts to awaken within you. When you're not being loved, as children, sometimes we don't feel our parents are loving us. We get a little bit angry. Mahishasura starts to rise within us. When we lose our image, when we're embarrassed in front of others, Mahishasura starts to rise within us. Basically, when we don't receive attention, appreciation, acceptance, or affection, Mahishasura starts to come out. What do you feel when he starts to manifest within each one of us? You start to feel maybe it begins with an annoyance, develops into frustration, can go into anger. If it continues, it can build up into rage. You become hostile, aggressive, and violent. And what are the sensations when you feel like that, when Mahishasura has risen within you? What do you feel? Agitated. What are the physical sensations? The body feels. Burning. No. So burning could be a sensation. You feel tense. When someone, if I lose my image in front of others, if someone makes fun, I start to feel tense. Okay? I start to feel rigid. I start to clench. My teeth may start grinding. My breathing starts to get rapid. And I can start to tremble, depending on how far Mahishasura is pervading me. And what does Mahishasura want? What does he want? He wants power, but ultimately, he wants to be heard. You're not listening to me. That's why I'm getting rage. He wants to be right. I am right. He wants to be understood. And he wants to be respected. And when Mahishasura comes out, what are the qualities that we start to be? What is our mindset? You'll notice he comes. When Mahishasura starts to become activated, you'll start to notice that you start to become competitive. And you start comparing yourself with others. You develop a sense of arrogance and selfishness. And you may also become obsessed with doing something, and it has to be done in this way. And you start to become dominant, and you're power hungry. And when you're in that Mahishasura state, how do you speak? You speak harshly. You speak using divisive language. It's us against them. It's me against you. When you're in Mahishasura taking over, you speak uncontrollably. I can get in a dialogue and I won't let you get a word. You start to become interruptive. You interrupt others and argumentative. My way is the right way. Listen to me. And you also start to offer unsolicited advice. When Mahishasura comes, you become separated from grace, from creativity, from peace, from love. And when I was doing this, when I was working on this talk, and I started slowly noticing Mother Madhukaitaba and Mahishasur. You start to notice these qualities within you. When you're driving and someone cuts you off, all of a sudden Mahishasur starts to come out and you start honking your horn. Doesn't he respect me? Does he know where I am? You start to notice these things. When I go to the gym and exercise, for example, Madhukaitaba are telling me, okay, it's okay, you don't have to go to work out today. Go ahead and sleep in. What's one day? This is Madhukaitaba coming. So what I found, this worked for me. When I started noticing them, you take Madhukaitaba, you take Mahishasura, what do you do? Offer them to the Divine Mother. Om Durm Digyai Namaha. Madhukaitaba, I offer you to her, to the Divine Mother. Two things begin to happen. You start to notice that Mother is getting well fed. She starts to put a little bit of weight, okay? And she becomes happy. And second, you start to notice that these qualities start slowly getting erased from you. Slowly they start easing away from you. So, now, for us in this story, when our lower propensities get too strong, when we start to, lower propensities means when we start going to things like addiction, when we start gossiping more, when we start watching TV, getting into the internet, when our lower energies start to build up and they rise over our positive energies, then what happens? Then all the gods, they first go to Brahma. What does Brahma mean? The power of introspection. Then they go to Shiva. I introspect. This is what's happening with me. I need knowledge. Give me some jnana. And then ultimately I go to Vishnu. I surrender to you, Vishnu. Tell me what to do. When this happens, all of a sudden, divine grace descends. And your heart is filled with unknown hope and confidence. All the powers of the gods and goddesses within you together become coalesced, singular. All that is good and great, all that is love and noble within you start to get linked to each other. And a unified feminine power begins to emerge within you. That is the Divine Mother, ready to conquer your enemies. And this is who Durga is. Durga is our awakened divine consciousness. Durga, Durgahati, Harini. She is the one who removes misery. You know Durga, what it means? Dur means difficult. Ga means go. The one you go with when difficulties arise. She takes birth within you. Now, when she takes birth within you, what do you think your Mahishasura is going to do? All of a sudden, he sees the Divine Mother and he's going to feel threatened. His existence is threatened. His possessions, his enjoyment, his status is threatened. And he doesn't want to let that go. Would you? So what happens then is we go into what's called a fight-flight mode, okay? Our rational, logistical mind turns off and our amygdala turns on. And we just act. We just react. We don't analyze. And that's what we talk about in this next, in this next series of battles. We see, let me just get your attention here first. What we see is Mahishasura is our rajasic ego. Needs to defend itself, defends what it has. So whenever we have a wound that's within us, when Ramakrishna gives the example, when a drop of water comes into a clam, open clam, it creates an irritation. We have a wound within us that irritates. What does the clam do? It puts its saliva around it. It doesn't try to tackle doesn't get rid of the water. It puts a covering around that water and creates a shell, and that's what we got, a pearl. So when we get these original wounds, we try to cover them up. We try to mask them. We develop a defensive protective mechanism. That's the rajasic ego. Has all these coverings, which are the defensive mechanisms that it uses, okay, in order to preserve its selfishness. So what we see here, I'm going to sort of go through this. In one sense, these six forms are considered the six ripus. Sri Ramakrishna calls the six alligators, you know, the crocodiles, lust, greed, anger. This is how the rajasic ego protects itself with these defense mechanisms. So the first one we see, he comes in the form of a buffalo. So a buffalo can usually be known as kama, lust. It's a savage beast. Buffaloes like to stay in mud, and they like to stay covered with avidya. They like to cover themselves in the ignorance. And so what happens is when they're confronted with the truth, when your guru says what you're doing is not right, Mahishasura starts to react in a very brute way. Okay? It refuses to accept what the truth is saying. And so what is the Divine Mother? The Divine Mother takes the noose and subdues it. Subdues your desire. Subdues that rage. Okay. Then what do we see? Mahishasura takes that mask off and turns into a lion. A lion can be like krodha, anger. A lion is also, in Buddhism, dharma protector. So what is Mahishasura doing here? Under the pretense of dharma, he acts in false dharma. He says, well, I'm actually doing these things, getting these possessions, and my selfishness, it's not really not for me. I'm doing it for others. It's not me. I'm doing it. Develops an escape mechanism. Excuses. It's not me. It's for these other people. Under false dharma, under false pretenses, our ego starts to take a shape. Okay? What does the mother do? Takes the sword and sort of cuts through that. All right? Then we see, takes on the form of man. And man can be considered loba, greed. Within the animal kingdom, man is the one that has greed. Here, man also has the ability to rationalize. So he takes his sword and shield. He knows how to defend himself with the sword, with the shield. He can defend your arguments, and with the sword, I can point to others. And I blame others, I redirect the energy. And so what does the Divine Mother do? The Divine Mother cuts through that, cuts through his arguments. And then, at this point, Mahishasura takes the form of an elephant. An elephant in Indian tradition is a source of pride, royalty, status symbol. I've got an elephant, okay? So now my pride is being hurt by the Divine Mother. So what do I do? The Divine Mother is too strong to attack, I see. So who am I going to attack? I'm going to attack something that you love. I can't defeat you, but I'm going to go after something you love. So I go after the lion. Okay. And I take my trunk and start dragging the lion. I start dragging your dharma, okay. Trash-talking your dharma, trumpeting myself, look what I can do with my elephant. I'm so proud. I can take your lion and I'm so great. What does the Divine Mother do? Takes her sword of discrimination, cuts through the elephant. Then he takes the form of a buffalo again, which can be seen as moha, confusion. Okay, someone asked me, why did he start with the buffalo and now taking a buffalo form again? Okay, in this sense, what we call it, he's going back to a state of regression. What happens when you're, say, with your friend or partner and you cannot win your argument? Okay, well, if you cannot win your argument, what do you end? You end up acting childish. You throw a tantrum and just walk away. I remember there was one person who was in Swami Swahananda's room, our Swami, and because you cannot get mad at the guru, what did she end up doing? She ended up just stomping away and boom, just closing the door. You act in a childlike behavior. Okay, you may give the person a cold shoulder treatment. Okay, you may not talk to them. Okay, childlike ways. And the Divine Mother, through pragya, the penetrating light, cuts through that. Until you get to his demon form, the asura, the root of the problem. And what was the root of the problem? Matsarya, was it envy? Maybe Indra was saying that, you know, I was jealous that all the gods were controlling the heavens. I also wanted to control them. I also want to have fun. So getting to the root of the problem, the Divine Mother takes her foot and steps on Durga. When we see the Durga Puja, we see her stepping on Mahishasura's neck. At this point, Mahishasura cannot change anymore. She's got to the source of the problem, pinning the problem down to its root. And she takes her sword, and just as she's about to kill Mahishasura, Mahishasura says, there's no other thing for me to do. I have to surrender now. I am helpless. So he surrenders, and he looks at the Divine Mother, and there's an act of recognition. I am you. You am I, letting go. The Divine Mother cuts that head. And the Rajasic ego disappears. This is the second story. And what happens then is the gods start praising the Divine Mother. They praise her with adulations, and then the gods end up saying this: "O Devi, whenever we think of you again, please destroy our direct calamities. And whatever human shall praise you with these hymns, may you also be gracious to them and bless them to be fortunate." The Devi said, "Be it so." This is the assurance of the Divine Mother that anytime we are in difficulty, we have problems, if you call on her, she will come. So, now we get to the final story. Okay, we're not over yet, okay? We've got rid of the tamasic aspect of the ego. We've got rid of our mala. In the Panchadasi, the first impurity of obstructions of tamas is mala. In the second obstructions of rajas is vikshepa, the scattered. Because of the scattered mind, we have emotional turbulence. We need to feel in control. We need possessions. Now we get to the third story, okay? And in the last aspect of the tamas, sattvic ego, we have to go remove the avarna, the covering. Okay. So we become satisfied and content with our achievements in the outer world. And now we desire less. We start to turn within, and we become more sattvic. Now we want to control the inner world. We begin to feel more joy from the subtler and refined things of life. We take pride in our ideas, in renunciation and spiritual practices. Then the obstacles of the sattvic ego begin to emerge. And so what happens here is now sattva is so close to Brahman. There's only a glass barrier that's separating the two. When you start to have the sattvic mind, what are the obstacles that one may start to experience? Anybody? What are the obstacles? Now, we know sattva means we're so close to Brahman. We start to feel the bliss of Brahman. We start to feel insights, knowledge. We can see people, we can see places, and we can get insight. We can see things that other people cannot see. We can read scriptures and know things that other people don't know. So what starts to happen? When you see spiritual holy people, maybe they get to that sattvic, they start to have pitfalls. What are those pitfalls? Distraction, pride, ego. Okay, good. So some of those distractions can be, we start to get pride in the knowledge that we've obtained. I know so much, I know more than others. Okay, we start to develop what's called vibhutis, powers. We start to feel maybe the sense that a spiritual pride, I'm holier than thou. There's a sense of superiority, a subtle sense of superiority complex begins to come within us. We start to, in meditations, we develop a sense of bliss and we're feeling, oh, I've made it. This is what it's about. We don't want to go further. We want to stay here. We start to become complacent and comfortable. And we think at that point, I'm done. I know everything. There was a Swami, again, I refer to Swami Swahanandji Maharaj. He had told us at one time when he was in New Delhi, shared this with us, that when he was in Delhi, he said that if you follow truth, he didn't say this, but we know Ramakrishna said, if you follow truth, truth will follow you. For a long period of time, if you're establishing truth, whatever you do, truth will follow you. So there was a moment in his life when he started experiencing things that started coming in his mind. People started coming in his mind. They started manifesting. So there was a week that people, places, situations would come up in his mind, and then they would manifest. What did he do? He ended up praying to the Divine Mother, please take away this power that's coming. It's an obstacle in my spiritual life. So now what happens is Shumba and Nishumba, they're both brothers, and they start to take over all the three worlds again, okay? And again, the gods become homeless, the gods and goddesses. And they end up going to the Himalayas. And then they remember, what did the Divine Mother say? She said, if you remember me, I'll come. So what did they start to chant? They started to chant the Yadevi. So maybe we can do a little bit of this chant to try to remove ourselves from that sattvic ego. So let's do a little together.
Yadevi sarvabhuteshu Vishnu maiti shabdita namastasyai 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 namo namaha. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu shanti rupena samstita namastasyai 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 namo namaha. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu chetanitya vidiyate namastasyai 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 namo namaha. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu buddhi rupena samstita namastasyai 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 namo namaha. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu nitra rupena samstita namastasyai 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 namo namaha. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu trishna rupena samstita namastasyai 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 namo namaha. Yadevi sarvabhuteshu shuddha rupena samstita namastasyai 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 namo namaha.
So what happens after chanting all of this? The Divine Mother appears. So beautiful, so glorious, such beauty. It's incomparable compared to any other beauty. So we see at this point, the Divine Mother appears, and then out of her, the beautiful form of the Mother, Koshiki. Koshiki means that which comes from the koshas. Out of the koshas, out of the sheets of the Mother, comes this beautiful, extraordinary vision of the Mother. Such beauty no one has seen. When we have that beauty, nothing else will compare to it. And what happens is two demons, Chanda and Munda, see this extraordinary vision, and they say, my master, Shumba and Nishumba, who have defeated the worlds and who have owned the best of the best, when you get to a sattvic ego, your taste of fine arts, you have the finest of fine taste, you appreciate beautiful music, beautiful dance, beautiful food. So Chanda and Munda say, my master owns the best of the best. He should also possess the Divine Mother because she is the most beautiful of all women to be seen. And they tell their master, Shumba, and he's Shumba. And then Shumba says, yes, and he sends a messenger to go get her. Now, who is Shumba and who is Nishumba? Remember now, at this state, we've gone from external world into the internal world. Now we're into the deep phases of our meditation. Now we're going to go through the several obstacles that we're going to go layer by layer into the deeper states of our consciousness till we merge with the Divine Mother. Okay. So Shumba is the sense of I, Asmita, our sense of the sense of our own ego. And his brother is Nishumba, which represents clinginess, mamatva, I and mine. Whenever you have an I, you need a mine. I is defined by what it identifies with. My car, my occupation, my husband, my wife. That's what defines I. I doesn't leave mine. Mine doesn't leave mine. If you talk about me, you're talking about my family. If you talk about my family, you're talking about me. I and mine. So these are the sense of the very subtle ego. And that subtle ego now is sending his messenger, Sugriva, to go and says to Sugriva, I want you to go and And I want you to go and get, through your sweet words, have the Divine Mother and have her bring her back so that she marries me. Okay. So what happens? Sugriva goes to the Devi and she says, "My master, Shumba, Lord of the three worlds, looks upon you as the jewel of womankind, and you must come to him and marry him or his brother, since they are the enjoyers of best objects." Now, the Divine Mother's Kaushiki says, "What you've spoken is the truth. But unfortunately, I made a silly promise to myself when I was a young girl. What was that promise? I told myself, whoever can defeat me in battle shall win my hand in marriage." And then Sugriva said, "Are you crazy? My master has defeated all the gods. You, a simple single woman, you have to stand no chance for them." The Divine Mother, "What you say is true, but just go tell your master. This is what I request." So Sugriva goes to tell the master. What does this mean? Sugriva. Who is Sugriva? Sugriva means one who has a good jod, one who's beautiful. He comes and he's requested through his words to obtain the divine. Can we obtain the divine through words? Can we just read some scriptures and think we know the divine? Can we possess the divine just by reading some scriptures? Through our words? The words are only pointers to the divine. They're not the divine itself. Scriptural knowledge cannot bridge the gap between the self and the not self. So what does the Devi do? The Devi says, "I want a fight." Why does she want to fight? Huh? Ego. She wants a sacrifice. What is that sacrifice? She wants a sacrifice of your ego. Nothing less than the sacrifice of the ego will be less than what than the emergence of the Divine Mother. She wants you to sacrifice your subtle ego. So, the first barrier that we come to is pride in scholarship. Then, Shumba and Nishumba send the next general, and that general is Dhurmalochana. Dhurmalochana means one who smoky-eyed, okay, obstructed vision. So with this obstructed vision, he goes to the Divine Mother. It's like, we think we've made it. We don't think we have further to go. And he tries to capture the Divine Mother, and the Mother with the simple Humkara, a simple chant of Humkara, disintegrates Dhurmalochana. The Divine Mother, we think we've made it. And then she destroys our obstruction and we see we have further to go. Dhurmalochana was also told by Shumba Nishumba, "Get her and drag her by her hair and bring her here. Get her, drag her by her hair, pull her back and bring her here." What happens in spiritual life sometimes is with distorted perception, first we don't recognize the Devi, and then we want to bring the ideal down into our world. We want to possess it. We think being spiritual is practicing yoga, reading some scriptures, chanting some mantras, and listening to Oprah Winfrey, okay? It's like we want to obtain the Mother and put her as another feather in our hat. Look, I do yoga, I'm spiritual. So, with the simple hum, which is a bija mantra, sometimes in puja you'll say hum, it's a weapon, it disintegrates. And Dhurmalochana is said, that obstacle removed. The next obstacle to come in the mind as we get into the deeper layers of consciousness is Chanda and Munda, the two generals of Shumba Nishumba. What does Chanda and Munda represent? Chanda represents passion. Okay. Munda is when you shave your head. It represents renunciation, withdrawal. These two refer to the movements of the mind. To external, there's the passion towards or the movement away. Raga, dvesha, attraction, aversion. The movement towards some external stimulus. Now we're getting to the upper regions of the movements of our own mind. So what happens is then the Divine Mother manifests Kali. Who is Kali? Kali is which that which controls time, Kala. So in our meditations, how do we go past the barriers of the movements of attraction and aversion? When we get into these deep states of meditations, going beyond time, all of a sudden, the movement disintegrates. And what happens is Mother Kali decapitates Chanda and Munda. And she brings Chanda and Munda to the Divine Mother. And she says this, "In this sacrifice of battle, here I've brought you the heads of Chanda and Munda, the great beast. Shumba and Nishumba, you yourself shall have to slay. You yourself shall have to slay." What's the meaning here? At this threshold, this is where self-effort comes to an end. There's nothing more that we can do humanly possible. At this place, now the Divine Mother, Divine Grace, has to take over. So now, what's the next obstacle that comes? The next obstacle that comes is now the Divine Shumba, the ego, sends its general Rakta Bija. Rakta Bija means, Rakta means blood, Bija means seed, seed of blood. What is the meaning here? It could have two meanings. One is, it could be, and there was a special connection with Rakta Bija. So there's a fight going on now. The Divine Mother is cutting Rakta Bija, and every time a drop of blood spills from Rakta Bija's body, he has this gift where the drop of blood will create a new Rakta Bija, a new demon of equal size and equal strength. So the more the Divine Mother was piercing and cutting him, the more blood was spilling on the earth, and the more Rakta Bijas there were. For us, Rakta Bijas can be thought of as desires, blood, red color, can be formed desires or thoughts. We have to now go past the thought barrier, the desire barrier. You ever notice that when you're meditating, when do you notice your desires or thoughts? When you're meditating. When you're supposed to focus on something, all of a sudden, they come and haunting you from all directions. And all the thoughts that you weren't thinking before, they come. And you feel hopeless. So what does the Divine Mother do? She tells Mother Kali, okay, Kali, open up your mouth and suck up, drink up all the blood before it hits the ground. So what happens? At this point, there's nothing we can do. Mom, I'm hopeless. Mother, take all these thoughts that I'm having. I offer them to you. You do them with what you want. You're putting them into the yajna fire. She absorbs them like the fire and burns them away. Fire is something that whatever you put into it, it burns. It burns the object, but it itself doesn't get impure. So she becomes that yajna fire. Everything becomes wiped away into her. Now we come to the last barrier. The last barrier is Shumba and Nishumba. I and mine. I and mine. Asmita mamatwa. I and cling and what I cling to. So now these two brothers battle together, the Divine Mother. And sort of like tag team wrestling. When one goes down, the other comes up. And there's an extraordinary battle that goes on. Finally, what happens is Nishumba comes and he's getting more and more hurt. And just before he's going to pass away, one last attempt he makes for his attempt for his own existence, what does he do? He sprouts 10,000 arms. When we're going to pass away, when our ego, what do? We start clinging to everything we know. These 10,000 arms represents our 10,000 identities. The different identities that we've had in this life and many other lives. And Nishumba, do you know who I am? Do you know who you're battling? We don't want to let go. Before death, we're going to hold on as much as possible before we let go. Remember the incident when Sri Ramakrishna touched Swami Vivekananda the first time? And Swami Vivekananda, all of a sudden, what happened? The walls started swirling and disappearing. The room started disappearing. And then he was going, wait a minute. What about my father? What about my mother? All our attachments that we don't know, we start to cling to. So with one final sword, the Divine Mother cuts Nishumba. And what is left now in that highest state of meditation, that very deep state of meditation? I. And what does the I do now? In its last attempt for freedom, it tells the Divine Mother, Do not show your pride to me, for though you are flushed with victory, you have fought depending on the strength of others. Because in these different fights, the Divine Mother has brought out different Shaktis and different goddesses, so there's a whole army here. What does the Divine Mother say? The Devi replies, listen, I alone am here in this world. Who else is there besides me? Look, all these Kali, my Shaktis, are but projections of my own power. Behold them now as they enter back into me. I have withdrawn all the many forms and stand here alone in my own glory and pride. Now I tell you, Shumba, be ready for battle. This is what makes this an Advaitic text. All the many are withdrawn into the one. And now you have your own ego, the subtle I, and the Divine Mother. So what does Shumba do at this point? All he can do is he lunges to the mother and grabs her. And then he lunges in the air. And they go higher and higher. As they're going, we're going to the primal cause of ignorance, to Ajnana, to the very threshold of where duality meets non-duality, that Bhavamukha state, the Bindu. And we're getting higher and higher and higher. Everything is disintegrating. The Divine Mother finally takes Shumba, that last vestige of I, and throws him on the ground. And with one thud, he disappears. And then, what is experienced? Nobody can say. Words cannot touch. This is the journey of the Chandi. From our tamasic ego, to our rajasic ego, to our sattvic ego, until we ourselves merge in the divine. This is what I think Swami Tathagataji Maharaj was trying to deliver to New York when he was chanting the Chandi, the blueprint of the spiritual map that's embedded in this book. So I want to end off with this. This here. Holy Mother has said, I am the mother of the wicked, and I am the mother of the virtuous. Never fear. Whenever you are in distress, just say to yourself, I have a mother. She gives us the assurance that she will be there for us whenever we need her. All you have to do is just ask. Just ask. So now I want to end this up. I made a small 5-minute video. When I was going through this process, at that time there was there's a group called Queen. Has anybody ever heard of Freddie Mercury? Okay. So he was becoming, this is just a few months in, I think he had a movie come out, so his name was being promoted. So somehow he caught my attention, and I started listening to his songs. And there was a song called Bohemian Rhapsody. It's a fantastic song. And while I was doing this, I saw Freddie Mercury was sort of this embodiment of Mahishasura. But in his life, do you know Freddie Mercury, by the way, those that don't know, he's considered, some consider him one of the greatest rock and roll musicians of all time. And for those that don't know, he's Indian. Many people don't know that he's Parsi. And if you can understand his music, it's a little bit, sometimes it's Mahishasura. But what I mean by Mahishasura is I get the sense of what Mahishasura wants and how he wants to be free. He's got to say, I want to be free. You know, he's struggling. He's struggling with all the addictions, with all the problems, but there's this urge that he wants to break away. And so I used some of his music to create this little summary of what we're going to see here. And I'll start explaining. So let's just hear it. Make sure we'll hear the volume.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy?
He's just questioning life. Is this the real life? Is this fantasy? Is this Maya?
Escape from reality.
Is this an escape from reality?
We will
now the asuras within us are starting to conquer our positive qualities, okay?
We will rock you.
So when the negative side, the selfishness, then my shastra, what does he want? What do we want? We want this enjoyment, material pleasure. My shastra, don't stop me now. And then with every enjoyment comes the turning point. We start to turn within. This is a song by Eric Clapton called Holy Mother. Awakening of the Divine Mother within us. So now the battle, my shastra is going to react to the Divine Mother.
I see a little silhouette of a man. Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the bandango? Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me. Galileo, 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 if he goes, I'm just a poor boy.
My shastra's excuses. Mamma mia, mamma mia, pleading to mother, let me go. Mother says, I will not let you go. Now the battle between the higher self and the lower self.